Saskia Sassen es socióloga, es especialista en economía global y profesora de la Universidad de Columbia. Su más reciente libro se llama Expulsiones, editado por Harvard. En la actualidad se van a editar en 20 idiomas y será en la edición en español la primera que salga al mercado. Por su parte, Richard Sennett es sociólogo por la ciudad de Nueva York. Es autor de El Artesano en el año del 2008. Ha sido galardonado con los premios Hegel y Spinoza, explorando cómo individuos y grupos tienen un sentido social y cultural de los hechos materiales sobre las culturas en las que viven y las tareas que desarrollan. Es también director fundador del Instituto de Humanidades de Nueva York. Con ustedes, Saskia Sassen y Richard Sennett.
Bueno, esto va a ser un poco pesado, pero es siempre para mí un gran... ¿Alguien me puede ayudar a sacar esto? Porque no logro sacarlo. Ah, ahí va. Es siempre para mí un gran placer estar aquí en Mextrópoli. Siempre muy interesante y siempre un público muy interesante también. La última vez fue hace 2 años para mí. Hoy quiero hablar un poco sobre la cuestión de la ciudad. ¿Qué es la ciudad? ¿Es simplemente densidad? No. Mucho de lo que llamamos urbanización hoy en día es simplemente el hacer de terrenos densos. Entonces quiero aislar, por así decir, qué es lo que marca la especificidad, la diferencia de la ciudad. ¿Y por qué importa? Importa porque en el espacio de la ciudad, en contraste, por ejemplo, con un distrito de oficinas privado como Santa Fe, en el espacio de la ciudad, los sin poder pueden hacer una economía de vecindario, una cultura, su cultura. Pensemos en los inmigrantes, por ejemplo, en Nueva York, y hacen historia. En un distrito de oficinas como Santa Fe, no hacen historia. Van simplemente a trabajar y salen, todo controlado. Entonces, a mí me parece que hoy en día hay toda una serie de condiciones que amenazan a aquello que llamamos la ciudad. Entonces, quiero empezar con una imagen que a mí me importa mucho, que es ciertamente un análisis parcial, y que es que nosotros hacemos. En inglés la palabra suena un poco distinto. We make, como we make this table. Hacemos justicia, hacemos injusticia. Hacemos igualdad, hacemos desigualdad. Repito, es una especie de análisis un poco extremo. Pero tengo solamente 20 minutos, entonces me voy a tirar un poco el lance en esta situación un poco extrema, digamos. Nosotros hicimos esto, lo hicimos. O sea, ustedes ya ven lo que dicen, ¿no es cierto? Eliminamos 3/4 del agua en 20 años de uno de los más grandes mares internos. We made that. That's a capability. No es una capability a la Amartya Sen, but it is a capability. Es negativa, claro. También hicimos esto, también en muy poco tiempo, eliminamos una capa de hielo, digamos, que ha estado ahí por milenios. We made that. Entonces, para mí el desafío es, podemos también hacer cosas positivas. Lo hicimos, y yo diría que la ciudad como espacio complejo es justamente una de las grandes producciones que hemos hecho. Entonces, una manera para mí de definir la ciudad es decir que es un sistema complejo, pero incompleto. Y en esa mezcla de complejidad y lo incompleto reside la capacidad de la ciudad de atravesar épocas históricas y sigue viviendo mientras que grandes empresas, reinos, gobiernos caen. mantener esa mezcla de complejidad y lo incompleto es crítico. Un distrito de oficinas no es, puede ser complejo, pero no es incompleto, es cerrado. La Ciudad de México va a vivir una vida más larga que Santa Fe. Digo, el corporate, ¿no? Ni modo, no me doy. Son otras historias. Entonces, es ese concepto de la ciudad que a mí me interesa recuperar. Y la gran mayoría de lo que estamos construyendo, en realidad, no es ciudad. Es simplemente dense built up terrain, terreno denso que construimos. Vuestra ciudad, ayer mi marido y yo caminamos bastante por el centro, es increíble. Además uno tiene la impresión, por lo menos donde estábamos caminando nosotros, que mismo gente muy modesta, gente que estaban pidiendo por ayuda, por así decir, sentían, esta también es mi ciudad. Y eso me parece crítico. Yo quiero enfocarme ahora sobre las amenazas que tiene la ciudad para seguir siendo ciudad. Una primera es un ejemplo que les quiero dar, que es una historia muy breve y brutal que se dio en Estados Unidos. Es una historia un poco compleja que tiene que ver con el desarrollo de ciertos instrumentos financieros. No voy a hablar sobre eso, pero simplemente invitarlos a fijarse, no sé si esto se ve, esto es cada año número de hogares que están bajo foreclosure, no sé cómo se dice en español, la gran mayoría a un cierto punto vienen echados fuera. Entonces en 2006 eran 717 mil, en 2007 1.300.000 mil casi. 2009, 2.800.000, estos son hogares, 2010, 2.871, etcétera, etcétera. De acuerdo a estos datos vienen de la Banca Central. De acuerdo a la Banca Central, cuando Bernanke se fue, cuando acabó su mandato, él dijo, para el año 2014, fines del 2014, inicios del 2015, habrá fuera de sus hogares, 15 millones de hogares, fuera de su casa. 15 millones de hogares son unos 30 millones de personas, por lo menos. Una de las cosas que yo examino en este libro nuevo que llamo muy softly expulsiones, no exclusiones, expulsiones, uno de los análisis es que este tipo de dinámica metodológicamente y teóricamente hablando, nos muestra cómo una condición extraordinariamente material puede ser invisible. Grandes espacios en vecindarios en Estados Unidos, casas vacías. Nadie. Lo mismo con los miles y miles que están habitando en tent cities, provistos por municipios, miles y miles, invisibles. O sea, yo creo que eso marca una de las condiciones que estamos viviendo, que grandes materialidades, que son también materialidades brutales, pueden ser invisibles. Entonces, aquí la imagen que quiero extraer para el tema que estoy desarrollando es tierras urbanas abandonadas. No hay gente, no hay nada. Hay yuyos y casas vacías. Y algunos de ustedes habrán visto las imágenes. Ahora, los europeos se creen que no pasa ahí. Sí, pasa ahí también. Y entre los que más tienen, así que vienen echados fuera de su casa, está Alemania. Y estos son anuales, estas cifras. Aquí 2007, o sea, 91.000, 88.000, estos son todos hogares. En Hungría, que fue el caso más extremo, 1.000.000 de hogares, en un país pequeño, invisible. La gran mayoría de los alemanes no saben qué está pasando eso. Y entre los países con menos están también países, como decimos, nice countries. ¿Saben lo que digo? Poco social, así, ¿verdad? Dinamarca, Netherlands, también están ellos. También aquí, entonces, espacios materiales, invisibles, abandonados, vacíos. Ahora, en otro vector que va acumulando todo esto, para mí es la cuestión de ¿a quién le pertenece la ciudad? Entonces, una de las examinaciones que estoy haciendo es las inversiones que están haciendo las grandes corporaciones, después del 2008, después de la crisis del 2008, ha habido un aumento enorme en la compra de lo que yo digo es la compra de tierra urbana. ¿Cómo se compra tierra urbana? Se compra a través de edificios. Esta cifra, yo tengo un data set de 100 ciudades, que son las 100 ciudades que en el año de mediados de 2013 a mediados de 2014 más capital inversión recibieron. Y México también está, la Ciudad de México. Entonces, ¿estos son nacionales y extranjeros los capitales? Aquí, o sea, entienden que estas son cantidades bastante grandes, ¿no es cierto? Y a menudo no pasa nada, compran y no pasa nada, porque es una manera de tener ese dinero ahí, digamos, ¿no es cierto?, para ver lo que pasa. Y aquí muestra así un poco más de una cantidad un poco mayor, 25 ciudades, y ven que después de las grandes, ¿no? O sea, se baja así, todo es un poco más, menos cantidad, pero es una historia. Las 100 ciudades realmente es impresionante ver. Y aquí está cuando es inversión extranjera, y Londres es la mayor. Algunos de ustedes habrán oído la observación que ahora es un hecho, digamos, que los cuataris, los reales de Qatar, tienen más propiedad, they own more en Londres que la reina de Inglaterra. Es verdad que la reina de Inglaterra lo es la mayor propietaria, pero eso para darles una imagen. Entonces, por eso yo digo también, es así un elemento, digamos, de una historia. Yo digo, esto no se puede reducir a la cuestión de la gentrification. Esto es más profundo. Esto es comprar urban land, tierra urbana. Esto no es así. Ahora, hay mucho más que decir, pero no hay tiempo. Al mismo tiempo, o parte de la explicación de esto, miren, estos son corporate profits, ¿no? O sea, la renta de las grandes corporaciones es Estados Unidos, 2008, viene la crisis, ¿no? O sea, van aumentando, viene la crisis, que para este sector dura media hora, exagero, son dos años, y después de eso, más. Es como que la crisis les dio más vigor, mientras que todas esas otras miserias que mencioné. Y si uno se fija en corporate assets, el valor de los efectivos, ni siquiera se nota, son 30 segundos ahí en alguna cosa, ¿no es cierto? Entonces, esas juxtaposiciones entre lo que está pasando, echando fuera millones de hogares, además del gran desempleo, de tantas otras cosas, y al mismo tiempo, estos grandes capitales que entran en la ciudad, y esta curva que gana corporate capital, esto es alarmante. Y por eso yo creo que en esa coyuntura, la ciudad se vuelve realmente una condición frágil de mantener cuando hay tanto capital que no sabe dónde ir y que empieza, digamos, a comprar tierra urbana. Mientras tanto, nuestros gobiernos se vuelven más pobres. La deuda del Estado, mismo Alemania, 13% en 1980 y 44% en el 2010. Estados Unidos, 25% al 61%. España, 14% al 51. Y estas curvas tienen alguna conexión sistémica. Tanta acumulación de capacidad de inversión, de capital en el corporate sector, y creciente pobreza en la población y creciente pobreza en los gobiernos. Estos son todavía gobiernos ricos, digamos, ¿no es cierto?, pero al mismo tiempo. Ahora, un factor que a menudo se deja fuera y que para mí es parte de esta cuestión de la tierra, y por eso lo digo que eso es en las sombras de la urbanización acelerada. A menudo, cuando uno oye especialmente a cierto tipo de persona, como políticos, digamos, no quiero ofender a nadie aquí, ups, pues me quedo, pero siempre dicen, ah, la mayoría de la gente vive en ciudades, como si eso fuera así un milagro que se dio. No, muchas de la gente que está en las ciudades son expulsadas de las tierras. Aquí, yo estoy haciendo un trabajo en profundidad de esto, pero aquí solamente para mencionarlos, entre 2006 y 2010, 220 millones de hectáreas se compraron, que compraron las firmas financieras, las grandes empresas, gobiernos, etcétera, etcétera. Esos son solamente unidades de más de 200 hectáreas, ¿no es cierto? Así que las más chiquititas no se cuentan. Y aquí hay una muestra, si se fijan en lo amarillo, o sea, África todavía domina, pero también está empezando a empezar en Europa, etcétera, etcétera. Un elemento muy importante para explicar la cuestión de la urbanización, la gran mayoría es para biofuels. Eso significa que el nivel de toxicidad de esa tierra es enorme y va más allá de las plantaciones. Las plantaciones y esa toxicidad son un factor que va expulsando gente que va a las ciudades. Entonces, yo creo que, así, esto es una acotación al margen, un punto muy, muy importante para mí es que tenemos que tener ciudades, no office parks, no gated communities. La ciudad puede manejar gente que viene, pero tenemos que mantenerlas complejas y abiertas, ¿no es cierto? Incompletas, pero abiertas. Ahora, estos land grabs, como le dicen gentilmente, van a aumentar porque hay más y más tierra. Mismo el famoso breadbasket de Estados Unidos se está muriendo. La tierra está caliente, caliente. Todavía hablan del breadbasket of the United States, pero en muchas partes del mundo, y ustedes en México también tienen un poco de esa experiencia, la tierra se está muriendo. Y yo digo, nosotros la matamos. Y hay entonces una recuperación de viejas tradiciones culturales y de cultura de cultivo, digo, y vuestros ejidos sabían cómo manejar la tierra, las plantaciones no tan bien, ¿no es cierto? Bueno, y aquí no, mismo quiero terminar con una nota sobre cómo la ciudad se vuelve también espacio estratégico para la cuestión del medio ambiente. Si nosotros implementáramos todas las policies, políticas, la diferencia sería esta en la capacidad de, en el nivel de destrucción. O sea, no nos sirve para nada. Esa es una aserción muy radical que si yo estuviera escribiendo no la podría emitir, pero estoy hablando, entonces la emito. Entonces yo digo, la ciudad tiene que trabajar duro, pero la ciudad, para to address, ¿no?, para manejar esto. Y yo estoy, un proyecto que me tiene totalmente apasionada es hacer funcionar o trabajar con la biosfera a cada superficie en la ciudad. Entonces, por ejemplo, para darles un ejemplo, hay una bacteria que si la ponemos en aguas, no sé cómo dicen ustedes, brown waters, aguas marrones, que es lo que producimos en cocinas, en baños, en restaurantes, ¿no?, que es un gran problema para todas las ciudades, porque hay que manejarlo y no se acaba nunca eso. Entonces, ese bacterio en esas aguas brown waters produce una molécula de un plástico durable, resistente y biodegradable. Eso significa, y es un ejemplo que les doy de muchos, recodificar lo que ahora es un negativo en la ciudad en algo positivo. Yo digo, y aquí solamente ya hablando de la cuestión del medio ambiente, ¿no es cierto?, del environmental question, pero esa es una manera de repensar también cómo el espacio de la ciudad puede trabajar para rescatar toda una serie de cosas, no solo la gente pobre y sin poder, pero también la cuestión de la biosfera. Quiero terminar con una nota que es una provocación y con un elemento irónico. Y esto es la cuestión, really, ¿quiénes somos nosotros los ciudadanos? Y ciudadano entendido muy, muy, muy ampliamente, y no es ciudadano versus immigrants, es así, nosotros que vivimos, etc. Este mapa, no sé quién lo habrá visto, es un mapa que está en el dominio público. Estos son 10.000 edificios que continuamente get information sobre todos nosotros. Si ustedes estuvieron una semana en Estados Unidos, están en ese data set. La lógica de este sistema es que para nuestra seguridad, security, todos somos primero suspect, sospechosos. ¿Qué tipo de sistema es este? ¿Cómo es posible que todos seamos sospechosos? Entonces, de ahí, ¿quiénes somos nosotros los ciudadanos? Quiero irónicamente introducir la ciudad y decir, si hay un espacio donde podemos scramble, mezclar todas las señales, de modo que terminamos todos siendo peligrosos, y en otras palabras, desmoronamos al sistema, neutralizamos al sistema, es la gran ciudad. Ese es un espacio donde no podés aislar un individuo con esta metodología. Entonces, quiero terminar con esa nota irónica. Muchas gracias. Ahora habla mi marido.
I am very glad to join you today in Mexico City, but I am very sorry that I have to speak to you in English. I want to talk to you today about a social problem which has implications for us as urban designers in the way we physically design the city. And this is part of a large book that I'm writing now called The Open City. And I just I want to lay out to you a particular problem. I show no images for this at all. So you have relief from visual overload. The problem I want to lay out to you is a classic problem of cosmopolitan life in cities, which is whether people who differ can live together, whether people who differ racially, as in the United States, or by class, this is true here and the rest of Latin America, by religion, as is true in Britain, where there have been explosions for political or cultural reasons, whether there is some way that they can live together, nonetheless densely packed together in cities. And this is a classic problem of urban cosmopolitanism. It's a problem first laid out by Immanuel Kant in a wonderful essay of 1784. And his answer to this problem of Kant never wrote about cities, and in fact he lived a very boring life in Königsberg, his own city. But his answer to this problem of how can people who differ live together was that they had to surmount their differences, and that the key to becoming citizens, cosmopolitan citizens, was to not dwell on the things that set them apart. This is an answer that I don't like. And my Open City project is an attempt to understand the conditions of cosmopolitan life in cities, which are more physical, which do not depend, as Kant depended, on rationality, rational discourse between people in cities. That seems all to me very nice, but it's beside the point of getting people to be able to actually physically inhabit the same space. One way I've tried to deal with this alternative to the Kantian cosmopolitan ideal, which is a verbal ideal, is to look at four conditions in the spaces of the city that might get people who are who differ to live more peaceably together. And I'm just turning the wrong page. It's terrible. Here we are. And I'd like to describe these briefly to you. And I'll list them first. The first is, this is what I'm giving you is a list of physical moves I think we could make as planners and architects which could serve this cosmopolitan ideal. The first has to do with porosity. The second has to do with incomplete form. The third has to do with synchronous rather than dialogical public space. And the fourth has to do with nodal rather than master planning. And I see I have exactly 15 minutes to explain these things, which have taken me years and years to understand. So I'll do this very fast and probably very poorly. Porosity has to do with the edge condition in cities. We divide edge conditions into two parts, or I do. One, which are borders, and the other, which is a boundary. A boundary is closed. It's a wall. It's something through which nothing gets through. A border is a division between parts of the city which is porous, not totally open in the sense that everything moves in every way, but that, like a cell membrane, allows an exchange between different molecules, if you like, or different cells in the city. The problem today is that most of the divisions we know in cities are boundaries. Eight lanes of traffic with no possibility of crossing the traffic center is a boundary. It's a boundary of motion rather than a solid thing. Whereas an articulated street form, which allows people to cross from one community to another, is a border. A boundary, similarly, is a gated community, that's obvious, whereas communities which are woven into the fabric of the city are border conditions. Shopping centers are forms of boundaries. Whereas a high street, as we would say in Britain, is a border. What we need to do is seek to transform the boundaries which define the modern city into more border conditions where there's more porosity between different places. And that's what interests me primarily. How do we make the city more porous? The second issue Saskia has talked on, mentioned briefly, which is the issue of incomplete form. To make a city that brings different people more closely together means a more flexible city, a city in which formerly isolated groups or isolated activities, as in an office park, can gradually be incorporated into the fabric of the city. To do that means architecturally that we need to have, in your very nice phrase, complete yet incomplete forms. That's a challenge for building. I give you one example. I was, when I was in the Planning Commission in New York, involved in a project to try to convert office buildings in Wall Street into residential apartments. They were built in such a way that we couldn't do this. Wall Street is depopulated. It's no longer the center of hegemonic capitalism. I don't know where it is, but it's not physically in Wall Street. But the buildings were built as though they were there for all time, in the exact same form. There was a complete tight fit between form and function, which meant that as the city evolved, its built form could not evolve. And this is a terrible problem for us today. It's a problem in the making of smart cities, and since I now have only 10 minutes left, I can't climb down this rabbit hole. But more generally, it's a problem in how to make vertical forms which can be reformatted. How to make skyscrapers into incomplete objects. It's the same problem with a shopping center. How can a shopping center like the ones I've visited here in Mexico City evolve so that in time they might be used for something else? To do that, we have to have a rethinking of the architectural imagination of form. And if we do that, the cosmopolitan problem that I've started with becomes more soluble, because it becomes possible for people to inhabit spaces that didn't belong to them before. Do you understand what I mean? That you can occupy space which is malleable and flexible. The third issue I want to talk to you about, which creates this more open condition for cosmopolitanism, has to do with synchronous rather than dialogical forms of diachronic forms of public space. And I'll explain this to you very simply by historical reference. In the ancient Greek city, there were two kinds of public space. One was the agora, which was a space in which many things were happening at the same time, and which is a space people, you could bank, you could pray, you could hire a prostitute, you could have dinner, or you could attend a law court, which were all happening, all these activities were happening at the same time. It's a synchronous space in that many things are going on at once, and that the human body can move through this space. This was a 10-acre space, with a sense of moving from activity to activity. Whereas a diachronic space was embodied by the Athenian Pnyx, which is a theater, a space for looking, a space for the continuity of argument. It was the kind of space that Immanuel Kant would have loved, because here people reasoned together. And the idea was, what the ancient Greeks called synoikismos, that people would rise above their personal differences and debate the good of the city. It's a space of the word rather than the agora, which is a more complex space of bodily movement, of conversations interrupted, a space of the eye, a more haptic, tactile space. Now, my argument about this is that what we want to do, if we want to make a more cosmopolitan city, is make public spaces which are more synchronous than diachronic. That is spaces which privilege the moving body, moving between many things happening at once, and disprivilege verbal rational exchange. This is a space, the diachronic space, is a space in which is a space of fragments. And unlike Kant, I believe a space like this allows people to engage with each other without having to explain who they are, what they want, to try and find that impossible thing called a shared common good. I guess maybe I'm getting very old, but I don't believe that by rationally we can achieve that kind of cosmopolitan city. I think the cosmopolitan city we can achieve is one that can be designed as a series of synchronous spaces. What this really means is redesigning our notion of public space, both in public plazas, but also in streets, so that they're very mixed uses, and uses which don't synergize together into one whole. So that is a principle of synchronous public space. The fourth planning and architectural principle I have in mind is nodal rather than master planning. I think master planning can serve some necessary and urgently good purposes, particularly in providing traffic infrastructure, water, and electricity. I think master planning is bad considered from the point of view of people's social and mutual experience with each other. I have been inspired, as we both have been, by, for instance, what Sergio Fajardo has done in Medellin, which is to try, rather than have a master plan that allocates all the functions of the city neatly, to put the same functions, in his case libraries, to say, I will help you find the money for these libraries. But like plants, like you plant a library in different places, you decide what purpose the library serves locally and how it looks architecturally. The idea is that in nodal planting, that it follows from the notion of synchrony I've mentioned to you before, that what we do is give localities the possibility of evolving their own architectural forms without having to balance, or communal forms, without having to put these into a state of equilibrium or harmony with other places. The idea of nodal planning is to provide resources, but not to demand coherence. Don't you understand what I mean? It is to leave groups of citizens the power to decide what works best for them, without trying to rise to this level of this Kantian level of what is best for the whole. So these are the four conditions to me where people, I assume most of you are architects or planners, where I think physical planning can make an enormous difference in the life of the city in terms of bringing into physical contact people who differ together, and in making them feel that the lives that they have when they're together, even though they're not resolved, are lives that they share in common. I hate to use phrases, but I would say that what I'm after here is the idea of embodied cosmopolitanism. This is not a regime which neoliberal capitalism is very happy with. For some of the reasons that Saskia has articulated, levels of foreign investment in cities, as they rise, tend to want to rationalize the way in which investment in unknown places works. The idea of the local, or of the potentially disharmonious or synchronous space, is something that's not very attractive to foreign capital, which wants assurances, equilibrium, and harmony. It also poses to neoliberalism the question of who is in control of the actual urban space itself. My proposal is for something in which people have amorphous ways of control, in which they experience the city as an unbounded, as an open condition, rather than something which is secure. And for all of its so-called dynamism, what neoliberal capitalism is seeking, above all, for those who have it, the capital, is security of investment. And what I am proposing to you is something which unsecures the pattern of urban growth and of investment. So, in exactly 20 minutes, this is part of the proposal I'm making to you, that we find another way for people who are different to live together, which has to do with physical co-presence. That there are four ways that I can see that we can enact this physical co-presence, but to do that means that we need to rethink the political economy of the city. Thank you very much.
And now we're going to talk to each other for 10 minutes. We need this to talk to each other. No, I'm joking. We are continuously talking to each other. And I have to speak in English. Me disculpa, pero tengo que hablar en inglés ahora, porque él todavía no aprendió el español. Es todo culpa de él, digamos.
What did you say?
I just said it's all your fault that I have to speak in English because you haven't learned. Él quiere saber todo. I really liked, and I hadn't quite understood that, all what you said about this multinodal and not this coming together around a central meaning, but multiple meanings. And I find that in my own work, my neighborhood work, I'm very interested now in suburban spaces.
Right.
And that they have their own way of being complex but incomplete. And they should all be active. And one image that I have is this notion of relocalizing pieces of the economy. You know, the economy, no franchises, no Starbucks. You know, make it in the neighborhood. And what you were saying about this, the dissonance versus, you know, if you could just elaborate, because I think that is actually a very important point. Not this notion of a central meaning, but multiple meanings. Not this notion that we all have to agree, but the fact, yeah.
Well, actually, this is an idea that came to me when I wrote a book on craftsmanship. And one of the things that struck me is that in good craftsmanship about objects, the idea is that what a good craftsman will say, what's wrong with this? Not, ooh, so wonderful, nobody has invented anything like this before. But to look at a piece of work, be very self-critical, and look at what's wrong with it. And that is a way of saying that the program for making something is incomplete. You're always looking at something that could be done to an object. Now, this is an artistic problem, but what came to me about this was that that's true socially as well. And basically what it means is divorcing form and function in any kind of absolutist sense. But it comes out of something every artist does, which is, it works, but it's not good enough.
And that then also comes to this whole question of making. The fact
right.
that, you know, meanings are made in cities. They're not, they don't come just from a central. And in our Teatro Mundi Global Street project, this notion, at least for me, that part of the cosmopolitanism that we admire in cities, and say, if I take New York, the city where we live, etc., the notion is that Manhattan's cosmopolitanism is radically different from all these neighborhoods full of immigrants with their thick cultures. And so I have a project, a little project that is part of our Teatro Mundi Global Street project, where I argue that part of that cosmopolitanism in New York, in London, in Paris, you know, in any big city, is actually the fact that the thick cultural elements of the neighborhood travel. It's like a trade route,
right.
eh? Una ruta de, como la Silk Road.
Silk
they travel.
Yeah.
And then they get sort of processed by the complexities of a place like Manhattan or central London. And then they become part of that abstract, supposedly, cosmopolitanism. And I'm very interested in recovering how some of those elements actually are of the neighborhoods are critical to have a cosmopolitan city. Think of any city that that is really thought of as a cosmopolitan city that is only locals, only middle class. It doesn't exist. You need all of that other stuff. And I don't know, I think then, and that then comes back for me also to this notion of making. So the question I would have for you is, how does this little project that you have heard me describe, how does that fit into your, you know? Don't tell me that it doesn't. Just camouflage the answer.
I would never disappoint you. No, it actually fits. I mean, I think we really need to the local is what our friend Ulrich Beck once called a zombie category. It's an empty category because people have local experience not tied to one place, but in particular the places where they sleep, but they have local experiences where they work. When you go to a hospital, you have a local, that's a locality. You don't live there. You don't sleep, well, I hope you don't sleep there. So, I mean, I think the thing about the local is that we need to free it from this zombie condition of having to do with a neighborhood which is fixed in place. Just doesn't, now think about with the all the social media, that's quite local, but it's not place-bound. That's the one wonderful thing about it. There are many unwonderful things. So that is part of this. I want to ask you, in turn, a question, which is really Lenin's question. What is to be done? What has to happen, and you can tell me in 3 minutes and 35, 33 minutes, 33 minutes and 30 seconds, what needs to be done to neoliberal capitalism to transform the city in the ways we want to do it? Should we bar foreign investment? Should we go into debt? Maybe we should be 500 times, our debt should be 500 times GDP. How would you answer Lenin's question?
Well, for me, there are many different vectors, but let's just focus on those that you brought up right now. So I would say, number one, we cannot govern financial capital, which is quite different, by the way, from traditional banking. But financial capital is so powerful, so innovative, in an accelerated fashion, that it will bring itself down. And that is what's happening right now. We've just seen the beginning. Those curves that I showed you, that after the crisis, more profits, more etc. Well, they have overdone. And now there is a report that just came out. Most of the big banks in the world are in trouble. And number two, the $17 trillion citizens' money that the United States government secretly, we only found out through Freedom of Information Act, put into the banking system, the global banking system.
This was the famous window.
The famous 21,000 request facilities. Yeah. Thank you, give me your cheap money. German banks, Swiss banks, etc. That money no longer exists now. So this is a very, and that is brings me back to the space of the city. The space of the city is a space for making. And so the local, I totally agree with what you said about the local, but I want to think about different parts of the city, so it is consonant with some of the stuff that you were saying, as spaces where making can happen, as spaces where we valorize each of the different actors. The grandmother has knowledge and she can be of use. The child has knowledge, the homeless person has knowledge, etc., etc. I don't want to be a romantic, I'm really not a romantic, I'm Dutch, we're not romantic at all. But, you know, I just want to sort of make present, etc. And I just actually finished a report that I'm very happy to share with you for Open Society, where I looked at what are all the applications in the digital field that can help low-income people and low-income neighborhoods. How can digital technology help make the neighborhood a social backup system for the low-income workers? We have very few applications developed. For it's all middle-class consumers or very fancy. And so there are, and some people who are working on this, they are saying there are a whole long list of things through which we can help. So for instance, your emergency nanny. It could be the hairdresser, you are a woman working or a father working, you have a crisis in the family. Little app mobilizes the emergency nanny. It could be the grandmother, it could be the hairdresser, anybody who is static in the neighborhood. That's just one little example. And that means, for me, it's just a first step in a trajectory that begins to mobilize people. Everybody matters, the neighborhood, the hairdresser, et cetera, right? And who knows where that goes? You know, that is a bit my whole issue. That is why I liked so much the first time I heard you put it this way. No, because usually you stay with Kant.
How could we
this way
him?
You go. Or so maybe wonderful. I go out of the room when you start talking Kant, and that's just the introduction. But today you actually, that's very good. I think 0 seconds, we're done. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
take your clock. Thank you very much.
Muchas gracias. En 5 minutos continuaremos con la siguiente conferencia con Alexander Apóstol.